Good morning, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us today. I also want to thank our virtual audience who is listening in. My name is Lakmini Perera. I'm part of the end user sales team at Schneider Electric. And it's such an honor to be your moderator today for this Women in Energy Innovation Talk happening right here in Mississauga. Before we dive into the discussion today, I want to share some facts with you. Women account for 39% of the global industry, but only 22% in the traditional energy sector. And for managerial roles, I'm sure you guys have noticed the statistics are even lower. And with the ongoing energy challenges that we face, it's important we come up with innovative solutions and new business models that are needed. And for this, it requires a greater participation from a more diverse group of talents. And therefore, Schneider Electric is pleased to host this incredible group of panelists to give the women the center stage and an opportunity to share their powerful stories and how they entered into the industry to some of the bold moves they made along the way. To kick off this event, I would like to invite Adrian Thomas, our country president. Adrian, the floor is yours.
Great. Well, welcome everyone to this hybrid Women in Energy discussion today. Really excited to learn from all our panelists what we can be doing, what we are doing, and how we move forward. With all that's happening and COP27 is coming up later in this month, the energy transition is more and more critical of how do we move forward. There's been a tremendous number of commitments made, but progress is slow. So we know in this industry, we're a key to solving the climate change problems. And for us to do this, we really need innovative solutions, and we need a workforce that comes with a variety of ideas and solutions. And so I think the topic today is about how do we bring more people to be excited into this, and how can we have more diversity in this business? And specifically, we're gonna talk about women in energy today. So very happy that Schneider Electric is hosting this panel today. Welcome to our virtual audience and welcome to our in-person live studio audience here. So back to you, Lakmini.
Thank you, Adrian. Before we dive into this exciting discussion, let's take a few moments for our panelists to introduce themselves. Sahar, would you like to start?
Sure. Good morning, all. I'm Sahar Borodinas. I've been with MCW for almost 4 years, and I've been in industry for over 10 years. I'm an electrical engineer, not mechanical. So I'm excited to be here today.
Hi, everyone. I'm Carol McGlogan, and I'm the president of Electro-Federation Canada. We are an industry association representing both the electrical and automation industries. I've been around a long time. It's about 35 years or so. I started in the lighting business, and I've been 6 years with Electro-Fed and enjoying every single minute of it.
Hey, hello, everyone. My name is Munshareh, Shafaq. I'm a digital specifier sales specialist here at Schneider. Have been with the company a little more than 3 years now. I'm an electrical engineer by profession. Very excited, looking forward to the panel.
And I'm Laura Smit. I'm the superintendent for water treatment and supply for the city of Orillia. I have been in the water and wastewater industry for over 20 years now, so definitely getting into the latter part of my career, and I'm very excited to join everybody here.
Awesome. Thank you so much. To kick off this conversation, I want the panelists to reflect on where it all began. When you think about that moment, what factors really drove you to come into this industry? Laura, would you like to start?
Sure. I kind of fell into the water wastewater industry by accident. It was a time in my life I was young, looking for something that earned more than minimum wage. I had some university, but hadn't completed my degree and was looking for a direction. And an opportunity came up at a local municipality where I was living and had been born and raised around, and decided to jump into it mostly because they paid more than minimum wage. There was no like, and I got into it. I was very green, but really took a shining to it. It hit a lot of the skills that I was looking for. Definitely when I came in, I can tell you I was the first female to work in that municipality in public works ever. So I didn't come in to break any traditions or set any new goals. Again, I was just looking for something that fit me and found the industry, and I was very well accepted there and continued to progress from there. So that was kind of my turning point. It wasn't some big aha moment. It was, how do I pay the bills? And it's that.
Which is most of us.
Yes.
Munshareh.
Fantastic story. So for me, I will start a little bit back, like how I exactly got into engineering for that matter. So to me, when I was a kid, I was a very curious kid, like, you know, those nerdy kids with their nose in books, asking why for everything. My parents are just frustrated that can they stop asking why? So I was that kid. So it kind of became clear to me, I think during high school, that I want to get into engineering. And I think that's where it all started for me. When I came to that decision, I think that there were a couple of factors that helped me make that decision easier, because we know, like, this is not in an industry that female take up very easily. So for me, I think I had a lot of support as a kid from my parents, from people around me who pushed me to take that step forward. And I'm very, very grateful for that. There was a lot of cheerleading going on that helped me decide on the path that I took. So that's how I ended up in engineering. And then electrical engineering was something I was very passionate about. And I worked for a company back in my home country, that's India. And then I decided to do my master's, and that's how I moved to Canada. And after moving here, Schneider was a company that was very well known back in my country. And when I came across the program that I joined Schneider through, it was looking like a very good fit for me. And I ended up here. So it has been a great decision by far.
Right.
So for myself, when I started, Dynasty was on. There was big hair and shoulders. It was a long time ago, and I was a business student at Wilfrid Laurier University, and I went to the careers department looking for a job after I graduated. And I remember a professor saying that you'll be in 5 jobs in your first 10 years of your career. And I thought, okay, I'll just go for job number 1, and I'll be there for a couple of years. I thought I was going to be pushing soap or cosmetics and Procter & Gamble, or maybe working at an ad agency, because that's what you think about as a marketer or dream about. Instead, I got into the lighting business, company that I didn't even know, Keen Wide Light of all places, and ended up staying for 30-something years. And they were purchased by Philips. And it's been an amazing career, amazing opportunities as a marketer, and just, you know, fulfilling overall. So I had many experiences within my first 10 years. I didn't have to go from job to job. I just had to have an employer, which I did have, and a mentor, which pushed me and gave me different, unique experiences. And that's my story. So
awesome.
That's it.
I have one.
Got in my-
I don't need. Engineering. So I grew up, I came from a country that was very male dominated, and all the decisions, it was Iran. So all the decisions were done with my man. So, and my dad is a mechanical engineer. So every time I saw him work, and I was very, very intrigued, and it's like, I liked what he did. And I wanted to kind of pursue a career there at that, I mean, in engineering, but I find it very difficult and next to impossible in a country like Iran. So, but when I came to Canada, I was like, my barrier will lift this. Like, you know, the kind of sky is my limit, so I can do whatever I wanted to do. So in order to kind of prove to myself and whoever that I was plus interested in math and engineering, so I kind of pursued a career in very traditionally male-dominated industry. And look, I'm here. I was on electrical. So, yeah, it was.
That's really inspiring. And many of you held different positions and took chances where it was male dominated, which brings to an interesting point and something, a challenge that we still face today, women being underrepresented in the in this industry. So my next question goes to Adrian. What are some of the reasons, in your perspective, women are underrepresented in the industry, and what can we do?
Great question. It's an answer we're all searching for. So I think from my perspective, it starts some great conversations around schooling. And you alluded to it in the beginning, but still today, I think when I was in McMaster Electrical Engineering, I recall we were about 100 people. There was about 3 females in my engineering group, right? So that's not statistic across Canada, but that was about 3% back in the late 90s. Today, it's still only around 30 something in Canada. So if you think about that, you know, how do we bring more people into an industry where the STEM kind of education system feeds into it? We have to start back in schooling. And I think, you know, interesting role model. So it was your dad, but I think also role models like Carol, and hopefully what we'll see here is a lot of people seeing like this is a career path for females. So I think that's one thing we have to work on. And at Schneider, we do work on STEM programs, early education. So that's number one. Number two is, I think we have to change the brand of energy. You know, when I entered, it was sort of like the electrical industry was gray boxes in a basement or in a closet. And that's not fun, regardless of your gender. But I think we can attract more people into the industry if we start talking about it. And you know, we see green around us. It's about sustainability. It's about the energy transition. It's about technology. And the kind of work we're doing now is digital. So there's like a whole new opportunity in terms of different work streams that we have. And I think we just have to make that more aware for everybody to understand. And then three is just to bring inclusion. So how do we make people feel comfortable, part of a group when they enter into a workforce? So the whole onboarding and the culture of the environment, one of the best things, and what we try and do is when we're interviewing, is to have a diverse interview panel. And, you know, I think that's the first representation of a company by a potential employee, is that first set of people that get interviewed. And if that panel is not diverse itself, then do you feel like you will belong? So I think we have to work on belonging. So those would be the three from my perspective.
Any comments from our panelists?
I mean, you want to
go ahead?
No, I do agree with you. I mean, I went to UFD not long ago. It was 2005, and it was 200 people. It was 10 of us were female, right? And a lot. And when you think about it, I feel like education system and even recruiter, they need to make the engineering job more appealing to women, right? Because to me, when you think of engineering, you're looking at going to this not very exciting office, just sitting at your desk, doing and not interacting, whereas there's so many different disciplines and branches of engineering, that there's power, there's electronics, computer, software, you can be a consultant, you don't have to be at your desk all day long. There's so many exciting things that you can do as an engineer. And a lot of time, I feel like that's not being conveyed if you think of engineering, it's just boring job sitting in a office. But exactly, that's a thing that's important.
Well, the one thing I can keep forgetting.
Yes.
So the one thing I think is so important is that this is an exciting industry. I mean, we don't have to make excuses. You don't have to apologize. I'm not just in the lighting business, or not just in the electrical or grid business or power business. I was reading an article in the Globe and Mail, and they say that when you start off in your career, first you're thinking about your discipline. I want to be an engineer. I want to be a marketer. Right. I want to be an HR person. And that's what you're focused on right up to your fourth year. But then when you get to those that later stage, now you have to pick an industry. And you want to pick an industry that's thriving. The electrical industry is thriving. Our grid has to expand by 2-3 times or even more. We talk about net zero. We're the ones that can impact net zero. And maybe this is not appropriate, but I think we're a sexy industry. So we are. And we shouldn't apologize. And it's exciting, and it's exciting for women in any kind of discipline. I do agree you need a math aptitude, and I always tested my marketers for math for the math side, because you have to understand how to express technical products and technical concepts. But you can have a place no matter which discipline that you're in.
But even taking that a step further, from my perspective as an end user, looking at it, we are very closely aligned to a trades, and the electrical and energy sector also needs those tradespeople. And for, you know, for everyone coming through, again, going back to that education piece, what we're seeing is everyone is told you need to go to university to get a good job to then sit behind a desk.
Yeah, right.
Whereas that doesn't fit everybody. And so in the trades, which is tends to be more college driven, getting out there and getting that field experience and hands-on. And the fact of the matter is, where I see that we could do a better job is getting in. So we might have overall support to show trades in the high schools, but for water and wastewater, that isn't a trade that people even recognize. So how do we, again, getting to that fourth year, knowing that there's all of these different industries, it's not just being a plumber or an electrician, there's way more options out there for just those pieces. And again, another part I think that we need to do a little bit better, even on the hiring committee, is, you know, I know walking into those rooms early on into my career, I very quickly was, how many women are in this room? Am I going to be the only one again? So making sure that us who are in the industry are visible, so that other people who might not have the same personality types we do, which is a little bit more, that's fine, this is what I want to do, and I'm a little bit more headstrong, then we can make those steps forward so that they're not having to, and they can just follow along behind. And I can say for me, very early in my career, going to conferences and things like that, I very much was one of three females in the room. Another one would be an engineer. And then as I've progressed now, 20 years later, it is much more representative, but we're closer to that 30%, not the 50% that we would like to see. So again, I think we need to help be visible so that people can see that this is an option for them and get out. And when they're early deciding that this is an option for them, to let them know it is out there too.
It's true.
Yeah, some great points. And like one more thing that I would like to add is that we're all talking about influencing female engineers while they're in school or having like a diverse hiring panel. One thing I feel we can do a better job is when students are coming in for internships, that's another key factor when they decide whether or not they want to continue in the same career. At least that was for me. So if they have a good experience early on when they're interning or when they're working in part-time jobs in the industry, if we can do something to provide them with a better experience at that point, I think that that's going to help in the long term as well.
So. Yeah, I want to carry this topic about having a diverse panel during the hiring process. I have read that when we are applying for a job, and believe me, I have done this in the past, when we're reading the job posting, we try to match at least 90% of the criteria.
Yeah, I've heard that too.
So do you think that using a different language might welcome more people into the industry?
I feel like you just have to build, as women, we don't believe in ourselves as much. I've read a book, it says, honey, you can do both, but then you can't do both, but it was crossed out. It says, you can do both. But that book says exactly that, that a lot of time if, as women and men, we're hired, we're applying for the same position. A lot of time guys will have 50% of the qualification. They will still apply and ask for more pay, whereas women, they have to match 90% and they will ask for less. So we kind of have to educate our, even ourselves, like have more confidence that, you know what, you can do it. You don't need to hit every single check mark. I feel like we need to educate our women and empower them and have better mentorship within our industry and companies. I feel like we're lacking mentorship a little bit when it comes to that. And so that way they know that they can handle and they can help with their confidence. And
I agree. And I think that, a simple thing that I've tried, and this is just for people trying to break into the industries as well and get that first job, which can be very difficult. You know, those entry level positions, you get a ton of resumes and they're almost all identical. How do you set someone apart from the other? But going to that is they don't recognize that when a posting is out, that's our ideal candidate. That isn't the one we hire.
That's true.
And so that's not a female thing necessarily. That's just in general, whenever you see that posting, if it's intriguing, it's about having that confidence, recognizing your value. I am also guilty of this as well. Not only am I saying I need 90%, I'm going to apologize for the 10% I think I'm lacking. And we can't. We need to walk in with that confidence and say, I bring value to whatever this position is, and this is why. And I think that's a people thing, not even necessarily a woman thing, just to have that confidence and know I can contribute something. If it doesn't work out, you've learned something, you've maybe brushed up on interview skills, all of those potential things we need to build on our careers, and the fit might not have been right. And then you move on to the next one, right? So I do think we could do a better job telling people who are job seeking, that's ideal. That isn't who we would be willing to work with. And again, working as a team and in that hiring panel, looking for the best fit for that team as well. So not just looking at technical skills all the time too, so.
Adrian, what do you think? I want
to
hear your perspective.
So we actually went through this. So there's a couple things. There are tools out there that actually will review a job posting and give you some insights in terms of gender balance. And one of the simple examples is we often just by default grab an old posting. It says he, right? Or sometimes you put he, she. But I think there's other ways that we can make it more inclusive. Back on the attractiveness of the industry itself, the other thing is we often talk so much about these are the tasks that you're going to do, and we don't talk enough in the job posting about the impact that you'll have by executing your job. And I think people get attracted to making a difference, and like there's so much we can do in this industry to make a difference, so let's write it down. This is the impact you'll have. And then on that 90-10, when I'm hiring, if you have 100% of it, I don't want to hire you because why are you interested in this? If you're qualified and you've already done it, what growth are you going to get out of this? So I think those, interview tip, take those, don't apologize for those 10%, make that 10%. The reason why you want the job is to get that experience.
Right.
And one of the other things that we've done, I would really, any managers to reflect on this is, but so often, what we do is we write down qualifications and we're trying to video or accept people based on are they qualified, and we don't even think about the profile. If you're in a sales role, you talked about marketing, why do you have to be an engineer?
You don't want to be an engineer, to be honest.
So you want to like, I have a passion for this industry. I like technology, or I like interfacing with, I like solving problems. Like there's so many different reasons you would go into that role, but then we put must be electrical or mechanical engineer, right? So let's cross those things off, and then we go beyond that 30% graduate rate that have that degree, and we open it up to a much broader population. So I think those are very simple things. We saw a huge difference in incoming resumes in some of the job roles where we were able to take off and look for profiles rather than qualifications.
Right. Munshareh, I don't know if you've awesome. The next topic that I want to discuss is about self-promotion. And many of you have a lot of experience in the industry, which means you held different jobs. And to get to the next position, you have to promote yourself to show all the great things that you're doing and the difference that you're making. And self-promotion is not a comfortable thing for many of us, right? So how did you manage that? Carol would.
Well, First, I'll tell a little bit of a story. I was in my, I don't even know how old I was, let's say 30s. There was a situation where I was promoted. I think I became director of marketing or something like that in the division I was in. And there was little fanfare made of that. This is what you are, and so on and so forth. And then there was a colleague of mine, a male colleague, and he got a similar position. And there was a dinner, and his wife was invited. And then there was this big celebration. Mm. And I had reported to the president as well. So I made my feelings known to this gentleman, who was a great mentor of mine, by the way. So I had a great relationship with him. And I said, you know, you gave me this role. I'm very excited about this role. And we just made it a little thing. I said, but when you did this for this other person, you had all of this fanfare. And why did you do that for him, but you didn't do that for me? And he said, well, you know, you're going to get more later on. And this is only, you know, one step for you. And said, but that's not the point. The point is whoever is being celebrated should be celebrated equally, not one versus the other. And he said, thank you. Thank you for telling me that. I didn't know. So that was my little cozy conversation I had with him. But in terms of self-promotion, I don't think it's self-promotion. I think you need to always talk about what your team has achieved. It's not about you, because people respond to numbers, people respond to facts, not, you know, so you talk about the sales that you achieved or the milestones that you hit and promote it, discuss it. Talk about it at your management meeting. Talk about it at your team meeting. Adrian knows from EFC, we talk about our successes quite a bit because it's about marketing. You have to market your achievements, your accomplishments, as if you are a product or as if your work is a product. So always be a marketer and don't think about it as being personal. You're just, because you're also marketing the impact of what you're doing for your company as well.
Thank you, Carol. I don't know if
I totally agree with you, though.
Yeah, I'll just add, I think that was phenomenal. That really, and I think men and women, it's this balance of like, am I being arrogant or cocky by doing this? And so you hold back. But promoting the facts, advertising the facts, the results, phenomenal way. And I think the other thing that you can do is you all witness fantastic results happening around you. So share them, right? And promote others. And you can help others by promoting them if they're not kind of raising their hand and say, look what I did. And then you create that culture of people sharing successes and everyone becomes more visible. So I would just tack that on, but I love that approach.
Perfect. It's true, because I mean, I sit in my Monday morning management meetings and I'm the only woman and with like 15 other eyes, and you see we talk about all kind of topics, what the project's coming out, which one we won, which one we lost. And at the beginning, because I do a lot of business development, so I bring in business for, and then I have projects that I win, and some are good, some are big, and I never used to talk about them. But I realized during those meetings, you see all these other guys are like, oh, you know what, this is my client, I did this and I won this project and I have a good relationship. And then he's like, you know what, now they speak up. But whereas as a girl, like, you don't typically gloat with your winning when you win, right? So I'm like, huh, you know what, in order to actually get ahead, you have to actually promote. Exactly. You have to promote yourself and be confident and speak up. And so that way, that's the difference between, I would say, women and men, because we feel shy. We're like, we don't want to kind of gloat, but I think you have to bring it up. And it does make a difference. And because nobody knows what you're doing, you're kind of sitting in your corner, you're doing your own thing. But if you don't talk about it, if you don't promote it, they won't know, right? So that's how you kind of you self-promote and get ahead.
And you're promoting your team, not
exactly
you. You're promoting your department, your team. So it's not I did this, yeah. It's our team did
that's
this
true.
Or our group did this. That's the fine balance, and people will know, you know, who's behind what, they figure it out, but it's your team. It's not a me thing.
Yeah.
So this is something I very much struggled doing. So I was talking to one of my mentors, and she gave a very good viewpoint to look at, which resonated with me quite a lot. What she told me was that when you are doing self-promotion or when you're talking about your achievements, try to think of the bigger picture as well. Like, maybe you not sharing something is depriving somebody else to look up to you for those achievements. So if you are comfortable sharing something that may influence someone else in the long term, then why not go ahead and do it? So that's another thing about self-promotion. Like, if I'm hesitant about sharing any of my achievement, let's say, I try to think of the bigger picture, that if I share this, what impact is it going to have? So that's another way to look at it. So, yeah.
I think that's a really key point. And I think that's one of the things, you know, I joke with people who know me well that I am actually very introverted. So something like this is very outside of my comfort zone. But at the same time, I can be very loud when it's something that I'm passionate about. And I remember sitting specifically, again, I have a story. I was sitting in a meeting with a consulting engineer. I was in with my colleagues from the municipality discussing the project. And they started using some technical terms that I had been around this for a long time, but I didn't have it. And I looked around and nobody else looked lost. So I was like, I'm not asking the question. Clearly, I'm the one in the room who doesn't know anything. I'm going to keep my mouth shut. And I went back because I do want to learn from those things. So I wrote it down and I went back to my colleagues and I said, so when they were talking about XYZ, what did that mean? And like, I have no idea. None of us knew. So after that, I said, forget it. I am going to be the loud one in the room asking the questions that really probably everyone else is thinking, but nobody is saying. And so, you know, it's not even, again, about self-promotion. It's just about, how do I make sure I'm doing the best I can do in my position, which is asking questions, recognizing team members, all of those pieces play into that. So, and so I do get recognized as being often loud in meetings, loud as in, if I don't understand something, I will continue to ask questions because I need to understand in order for me to do my job. So.
I just add something, and it's not, the other thing we have to do is, in talking about the facts, it's the good and the bad.
Right.
You can't always just talk about the good things. What you can do is you can also share things that aren't going well, but then also talk about what a solution might be or why we need to focus in this area. So if you're only ever showing all the good stuff and hiding all the bad stuff, you lose a little bit of credibility because people see through that as well. So I think it's just, don't be afraid to speak, whether it's asking a question, telling the good, the bad, the ugly, and trying to be as honest as you can so that you can solve the problem as a group.
You all bring up a very important perspective to self-promotion, promoting as a team, because there's no I in the team. And that brings me to my next question. Laura, you mentioned that you were almost the only female when you joined this industry. Yeah. So what was the key catalyst that helped you to progress in your career?
A couple of things. I think, you know, a support system, as you had mentioned as well, is so key. So, you know, I remember, and I'm working in public works when I first started. I am boots on the ground in a shop with a bunch of guys who are truck drivers. This was a huge shift for them. So for the first 3 months I worked there, it didn't matter if they were talking about the weather. The second I walked in the room, the conversation stopped because they were so afraid of what I might do. And so, I'm just a person. I'm just a person. You can talk about the weather or the Blue Jays or whatever, right? So it took a little bit of feeling each other out. But I had a really strong management team that stood behind me, that, you know, my gender being different was not something that needed to be taken into consideration. I was working side by side. Either I could do the job or I couldn't. And that that kept me, I was a little bit insulated somewhat that way. I still got outside perspectives, but I got brought up and along with that support system. And I think, again, if my experience had been different early on, there's probably no way I would have stayed in this industry. But because that wasn't how we looked at it, and I can say, you know, it was the township of Severn that was, and so it's a rural, small municipality, and here they are hiring this young. So one, I'm just out of school, I'm in my young 20s, and hiring a female to boot as well. So it was a challenge, definitely dealing with the public also, dealing with salespeople who weren't used to, accustomed to dealing with women in the, was challenging, but again, building that confidence over time. I have methods of working around that now that people generally don't like, but it's things like I go to their bosses and mention that, you know, I'm feeling like they're not taking me seriously. So, but being courageous and brave to be able to take that step, not just hiding and saying, I don't think this is for me, but that support system right out of the gate was probably the most, the biggest influence for me.
And what about you, Carol? I want to hear, I know you have a such a long. So what were some of the key steps that you took along your journey that helped you get where you are today?
So I guess it was getting into different areas. So I started in marketing. I even got involved in product development for a little bit. I ran the engineering team for a short period of time. Got into channel management, which is managing the distributor relationships. I also manage the sales organization. I think as a marketer, it's really important to understand the business. So I had very good mentors that taught me the business. I had a wonderful gentleman by the name of Avi Drazen. He's no longer with us, but he would teach me how he was thinking about things, and he would tell the story behind a decision, and he was like a grandfather in a way, and that's the way he was with everybody. So if you can find that person who's the storyteller that gives you the why behind things, and I think the why is so important, and if they're not willing to give you the why, go ask the why, mm-hmm. and then that'll at least give you some insight as to how that, why that decision was being made. So I had people that, you know, that did promote me and support me. I never felt that, oh, woe is me, I'm a woman in this industry, even when there weren't other women around. I never felt that way. Nobody in the industry made me feel that way. So I can't say that, as a matter of fact, sometimes I thought it was a little bit of an advantage. It's much easier to remember that one woman that's in the room than you're one of 600 men and which guy was that, right? So you can, if you flip your thinking, it can work for you.
And Sahar, I want to know, I know you talked about your dad inspired you to go into engineering and enter this, into the industry. You also mentioned that you're part of outside organizations, outside your company, to inspire other females as well as to get more involved with this industry. What do you think about the women representation in the outside organizations?
We've come a long way, but then there's still moving. There's a lot of room for improvement. So I would say different sectors, they have better representation and some are still lacking, for example, academics and government sector I would say they're doing a better job promoting, whereas I feel like the construction, engineering and energy, we're still lacking and we're very behind in terms of that. That's why I'm part of SWE, which is Society of Women Engineer. And I do see a shift. It's getting there. I'm working as a part of project, which is Reina, which is a condo. The whole idea of Reina came about by these developer Spotlight and Urban Capital, that they said, you know what, as women, we're a part of, we design a lot of projects, but we never get the front page and we don't get the glory for it. So So a couple of years ago, they put a team together. The entire team is comprised of women engineers. So the developers are all women, the construction manager, all women, all the engineers, all women. So I do see it's happening, but I think it's very slow. So we need to work on it. And I do believe events like panel discussion like this, it is helping and promoting it. So we're moving in the right direction.
And it's interesting to see how the industry progressed massively, but we still need to do a lot more work to make it even better and more welcoming. My next question goes to Munshareh. What were you surprised about when you entered into the industry, since you're still in your early stages of your career?
So I think for me, the biggest surprise or shock was the ratio, gender ratio, like Adrian mentioned, 2 or 3 engineers out of 100 in the late 90s. But it was not very different when I went to school in like 2012. Like we were 9 female electrical engineers in a batch of like 70 people. So that came as a shock to me, because till high school, the ratio was almost 50-50. Like, my major was science, and high school, I did not see the difference and then suddenly when I'm into engineering, nobody told me that there will be no females. So I was like, okay, what's going on here? And then I think eventually the other thing that surprised me, again, like about education, I'm not talking per se about the industry, is that I felt that the male peers treated the female colleagues a little differently. So it was not always a negative thing. Like it could be as simple as this, that if I'm working in a workshop, I'm welding something, I'm offered support that, can I do this for you? And which was okay. But then the thing is, when I reflect back on now, I understand is that that would change the kind of education that I'm receiving, because I would not know how to do it if I let somebody else do it for me. So that was another thing which I was surprised by, because that did not happen until high school. Like till high school, there was no differentiation. So yeah, a couple of things.
Yeah, I think I can relate to you as well. We graduated around the same time, and I went to U of T, and I saw less women going to electrical for some reason. And at that time, we had 1-10 ratio easily. I could count all the girls in my class. But I think it's getting better now, which is a very good sign. I think part of it brings back to education. A lot of young females don't really know what STEM is and what options are available when you enter into the industry, unless you have a parent or a mentor who gave you that exposure. So that brings me back to the next question. This goes to Adrian. What do you think companies can do to push more mentorship for new coming employees?
Yeah, I think start just onboarding and making sure you have an appropriate buddy. So that's not even mentoring, but just onboarding. And that's not just new recruits, but it's also mid-level and senior level people coming on board, because no company today is simple. So there's a complexity, and navigating that complexity is probably the biggest impact you can have of a successful onboarding. So an onboarding buddy is critical. In terms of mentoring, two thoughts on this. So one, create space for people to have mentorship conversations within the workday, and to promote them as programs. So officially kind of saying, this is what we want to do. Internal and external. So we actually, at Schneider, we belong to Women in Governance, and they actually offer specific mentoring for women in the workspace. And that actually is so you get some experience of mentorship outside of your own organization, which I think is important, because there's this whole diversity of experiences and workplaces. And so I think, you know, having a dedicated or official program is like sanctioning that, hey, this is something which is okay to do and you should do it. On the flip side, I think we have to be careful of always having official mentorships and thinking of mentorships as like a one-to-one and this person's my mentor and that's it. And to think there are, I would say I have multiple mentors. It depends on what the topic is, you know, and you know people that are good at this or good at that and leverage them. And a mentorship can be just like a talk. It can be, hey, I'm going through this. It looks like Sahar, you've been through this before. Can you give me your perspectives? And so there's formal mentorship. And then there's also like, think of maybe like a board of directors, like who would you go to and ask questions for? And as Laura said, don't be afraid to ask. Go try and solve it in your brain. Just go ask somebody.
Yeah, it's important to have many different mentors because, again, it's not one area that they can help you out. Overall, it will add more benefit along the way. So do you see a lack of representation of women in the senior management is due to the mentorship or improvement that we can do on the mentorship?
I think that we can certainly see more representation by women in leadership across the board. I think we're lucky to be living in Canada, so it's the whole 50-30 challenge that the government is doing. Public entities are really pushing this. I mean, there's studies. A lot of banks have higher degrees of women in leadership and board positions than other industries, and they've compared performance, and they see that benefit in performance. So I think just from a business standpoint, like there's a desire to get there. The challenge is how do we move there as we have small percentages of the workforce, right? So you're looking for, you have a very small pool of candidates to pull from. So I think what we need to do is make that pool as big as possible. And so we talked about, exactly. This goes, I mean, all the way back to, you know, we talked about engineering, but STEM is more than engineering. So how do we bring profiles? How do we get more people just, I mean, yeah, more marketing people, right? And Carol's had a very successful career in the energy space coming with a marketing degree. So we have to open up our minds to get more of that in. And then that sort of will progress through. And I think we can do it even at mid-management and senior management. Actually, the higher you go up, the easier it is, I think, to bring someone in from out of the industry because some of the basic business dynamics are the same.
Any last words from our... That brings to, I have a question with regards to the managerial styles. We went through this unexpected period with COVID, and I have read online that post-pandemic, many of the companies have shifted to more empathetic and engaged with their employees. Did you see with your managerial style, it changed a little bit post-COVID?
I mean, I can, I wouldn't say much. The way I like to manage my team is build a great relationship, train, and do a great job mentoring your team, and then they can just run with it, you know? So you don't have to, because I don't like the style where you're micromanager and you're always like checking on what they do. So you have to build a great team and then let them run with it, and then they can come to you for support. So I don't think COVID really affected it, and my team is doing a great job, and I have a really easy, like, relationship with my team. Like, we're just friends and buddies, we joke around, it's a very light, because I don't like the it makes it working easy, so much easier with your team, and they feel comfortable, and they think of you as a friend versus like somebody who's like superior. Yes, when it comes to it, you have to be, when it's like comes to work and deadlines, you have to kind of push, but the other time we're just very easy, relaxed, go for it.
I don't know that COVID changed my management style very much. Where I can say in my current role, I've been at the City of Orillia for about 4 years now. And again, in our division, I am the lone female manager with a bunch of men. where I am, I would say that I have made a positive impact because I have a different style, because I tend to, as Carol had said, I want to build a team. Let's do this together. It's not about me sitting in a different office and barking orders at anybody. Let's all go do this. Part of this is I came up through the industry, so I've been in those roles as well, so I can relate. And I've seen a bit of a shift in some of the other managers' styles. It might have been a little bit more of that empathetic and, you know, willing to have the conversations that aren't necessarily work related, but it's a challenge that they're going through, or, you know, keeping, and in that scope of mentorship, keeping the door open. We said, if you want to talk about what's the best role for you, it doesn't have to be here. Like, you know, talk to me about those things, and I can, if there's a better direction or something else that you're thinking of, I'm not going to be running to HR and saying, oh no, this person's thinking about leaving. I hope that we can maybe have a conversation to not have that. But if that's the best choice for you, then why wouldn't I want to celebrate that success too? So, you know, I do see a positive impact that I have a different management style than the rest of them. And it's starting to slowly shift and change their perspectives a little bit. So, which is, I hope, positive.
What about you, Carol?
Well, I think the whole issue of wellness has reached a critical point during COVID. The mental health side, the inability to be as physical as we were in the past, the dropping of some of those physical habits, the things that make you feel good overall. So it's not that the management style has changed, but there are new concerns that maybe weren't there before. And when people are more remote, the only way you can address those concerns is actually pick up the Teams call and do that purposeful, because you're not going to run into them. There's no water cooler, right? There's no water in the fridge or lunchroom and whatnot. I mean, a lot of our staff are still at home. We get together for collaborative moments is what we do. But those collaborative moments are fewer than just the day to day. So I think making that conscious effort, and as a result, in a way, I've had some more personal conversations with people than I would have in the past, because in the past I thought everybody was just okay, and now I'm a little bit more worried as to whether or not they are okay. So maybe it's the mother. but that's it.
Yeah, it's the caring leadership style that that really make you powerful, right?
Can I add something? Yeah. I don't know if this is completely related, but one of the things in COVID, and we're experiencing it right now, is this hybrid environment that we're in. I don't know the precise stats, but something like 2/3 of primary caregivers are female and 1/3 are male. So COVID actually kind of opened the door to this hybrid work environment and the ability to kind of balance work life priorities, and particularly like whether it's children, older parents, whatever, this flexibility is super important. But I think it's also super important both for employees and managers to think about this and the whole concept of inclusion. What I heard a lot of the conversation was here is the onus is on the women to raise their hand and speak up, but it shouldn't be, right? So there's also the onus on teammates and managers to make sure everyone's heard. And part of it. And in a hybrid environment, that's super hard. If you have some people here and you have some people on a Teams call. So I think it's really important. One, if you're running a hybrid meeting, to figure out how to purposefully include the people who are coming in remote, because they don't necessarily have the choice. I would also say flexibility should be both ways. So if your employer gives you the flexibility to have that time at home to balance that, when you're available to come into the office and be in person and be with people, do it.
Right.
So I think that's the exchange that can happen. And then I think it's great that COVID gave us this hybrid environment, which allows flexibility, but it's up to both the companies and the employees to make it work, which means including the hybrid or the remote people. And then if you are remote, when you're available to be in person, make the effort and come in and be in person so that you can be seen.
Oh my God, I love the part you said, the onus is always on us, right? Never thought about it that way. Cause I mean, working such a male dominant, you always kind of want to I mean, you're trying to change yourself to make the system work, whereas, you know what, you're right, because there have to be other measure put in place for us. Like, we shouldn't be always thinking, like, how are you going to make it work versus, that's a good point. So. Now, like, you know what, I kind of turned some of the light.
Tomorrow you're going to say, what are you going to do?
Exactly.
Well, I heard it multiple times.
Actually. Yeah, because you know what, you yeah. I don't know if anyone is.
Yeah, I mean, my biggest takeaway is speak up and be courageous and connect with each other. And we saw that a lot during the COVID time and how adaptive everybody was. And it didn't matter where you were located in the country, and it didn't feel like you were working from somewhere else. And I know we're closer to the end of the hour. So before we take up the questions online and also from the audience, I have one last question for the audience, for the panelists. What advice can you share with anyone listening right now and also in the audience who are interested in coming into the energy sector?
I can start. I would say that if this is something that you think you're interested in, take that first step. Have a conversation with somebody else that you know is in that industry. Pick their brains, get that information, and take that step, because there's definitely room for everyone. Something that'll fit, and just keep searching for it.
Yeah, and just to add to that, like, if you know that you are interested in coming into this industry and you are intimidated by it, just find yourself a cheerleader who will keep pushing you to achieve it. That worked for me. So if you are looking to get into the industry, just do that for yourself. So that will be helpful.
Take a chance.
Yeah, take a chance.
I would say this industry has a place for everybody. So no matter what your discipline, we need HR, we need IT, we need data analysts, we need marketers, we need salespeople. So it's not limited by your expertise. It's just limited by what you know about us and your willingness to give the industry a try. Because, you know, if you're like me, you get hooked. And for a long time, just because it is that great. And the people are wonderful, too. So
I like that. So I'm going to say the onus is not only on you. We're here to help. And that's what we're, you know, we have a group of people like right now. We're trying to pave the way for you ladies who want to get into this industry. And there are a lot of great position and great. You'll meet great people and you'll do great. So.
And just one last bit about what you said. I would like to thank all of you for being there before people like me and Lakmini came on board. You made our life much easier. So thanks for that.
Yeah. Old ladies. It's okay.
Yeah, and I mean, I what Munshareh said. But yeah, thank you so much for the. To all of you for inspiring and sharing your advice and paving the way for the future leaders. Now, I think we are ready to take any questions from the audience as well as from online.
Yeah, questions online. So again, in the spirit of including those of you online, thanks again for joining us. A couple questions have come through the queue. Adrian, earlier you talked about education. At this time, we focus on post-secondary for the most part. However, studies show that by the age of 13 or 14, many girls in particular begin losing interest in STEM professions. How do we begin driving this down further into the education system at an elementary level? What can organizations do?
I think you asked what can organizations do. So I think the kinds of programs that organizations participate in here in Mississauga, we're part of the Mississauga Board of Trade. We have a program. We're trying to figure out exactly that, working in primary, and a lot of that work is really on educating parents on what the career opportunities are. Parents have a tremendous amount of influence, parents and friends, right? And I think to Carol's point earlier about the impression of the industry and the energy industry is, I think we used to call it the electrical industry. I think, you know, kind of transforming what does that mean? And getting people interested, just real, my daughter's in that frame range. She's like, what should I do? And you want to be an engineer? I don't know. And I said, how about an energy professional? And she was like, oh, that sounds cool. So engineer didn't sound cool. Energy professional did. So in terms of even, you know, how we brand what we talk about is really important.
Any comments from you? Anybody else in the audience? Or sorry, on the panel? Related to that?
Yep.
Just agree with what you're
The second question really is about unconscious bias. So how have you ever overcome unconscious bias at work without causing conflicts in the workplace?
That's one of the things I wanted to kind of talk about is one of the things that surprised me coming to this industry is challenges, like a lot of stereotype, right? Saying, right? I mean, that Reina project, I've heard so many people telling me, it's like, oh, they're going to be all, the building is going to be designed by women and no project, the job's not going to get done because nobody can make decision. Nobody wants to live there because it's designed by women. And that came from people that within my own industry. And it's kind of, it's sad, but all we can do is kind of just, you know, I mean, don't let those things like that bother us. And just but the way we did it, just, you know what, I'm going to work my ass a lot harder, work my ass off. I'm going to do a great job and, you know, prove all the people that, you know what, we can do it. So there are a lot of biases. And even the thing that people thinking that women are the caregiver and the housekeeper of the office. I'm like, why would you even think that? Why would you think that I would want to do that? You just have to, you have to be direct and don't let things like that bother you. Yeah.
I think there's, you know, when it comes to unconscious bias, I mean, Adrian talked about it in the hiring process, is having a diverse panel helps with bringing new people in. I think when you become a manager, it's important because there's always a bias. It could be, you know, the sports that you played or the neighborhood that you came from. Like, there's all sorts of biases. And we just have to make an effort to have people around us that think differently than we do. And for me, it's more diversity of thought than anything else, because we can probably find a whole bunch of mini-me's that look different, but they're actually the same. So it's more about the diversity of thought. That's important.
I'd like to add on to Carol. So let's talk about the elephant in the room, my Movember mustache. But there's a great Ted Lasso quote, which is be curious, not judgmental. And I think, you know, for unconscious bias, we're judging first and not learning. And when I heard Carol talk about all these different things, these are extremely curious points to learn about some experience and background people will actually bring to the role instead of sitting there and judging someone for that background. So there is a lot to be said about kind of just making that mental shift and say, well, why am I excluding this person? And then turning that into questions and why, and how does that help them bring something of value into the organization? And I also believe it starts with ourselves, right? So recognizing the things that are going through our mind, and there's some great online tools you can take to learn about some of your unconscious biases. Yeah. So happy to share some.
Okay. I think that one of the things, especially if I wasn't always comfortable approaching those biases, that sometimes were very blatant as well, not even just the unconscious bias, is I tried to take a step back and just let my work product speak for itself. So let me be me. I'm still myself and I am going to keep going forward. Don't let those people stop you cold in your tracks. Mm-hmm. Hopefully it's not somebody who's in your management team that you're running into those kinds of things, that you have support from other people and you can kind of work around that. But focus on, you know, don't try and, there's lots of people who are open, but can't always convince somebody else of making a change of mind. So just do what you need to do and focus on that as well.
What's up?
So
maybe repeat it? So you guys spoke a lot about mentorship, as well as taking the onus, maybe in two separate streams. My question for you is, for those that currently don't have mentors, and I know some companies go out of their way to provide some, like Schneider has done, but maybe not everybody is fortunate. How can they either leverage online tools, social media, or what advice generally would you give them to go about finding a mentor or asking somebody to be their mentor? Where would they find them? How would they approach them? Do you have any general advice about that?
One of the first things I would say is that it's exactly what you were saying earlier. It doesn't have to be, will you be my mentor? It just has to be a conversation. Let's go grab a coffee. I would say for somebody who's looking for that mentor, and again, I also have like the board of directors, it depends on what it is or what I'm looking for whom I'm going to go speak to. We all have mentors, regardless of what stage of our career we're in. We still need a sounding board. We still need advice. So I would say look around to the people that you have, whether it's in this industry, whether it's in other industries, and somebody that you would like to emulate, that they have a characteristic or skill set that you'd like to look at, and just say, hey, can we go for a drink? Can we go have a coffee? I'd love to chat with you about that. And again, you know, we're not very great at self-promotion, but most people like to talk about themselves. So, you know, just pick their brains. How did you get into this? Where have the same questions that we were answering and go from there. It doesn't have to be a formal structure where this city does have a mentorship program. And one of the things I struggle with, I have lots of informal mentorships, but our mentorship, they're supposed to come as I'm the mentor and there's a mentee. The mentee is supposed to come to our meetings with an agenda. And I'm like, I don't like that. That's not my skill set. I want it to be natural. What's on top of mind? What do you need to know? What's happening in your world right now? That's what I'd rather have those. And that's that one-on-one conversation. That's all it needs to be, really. So not to be something afraid of. Don't have to label it as something. It's just going to be somebody that you respect in what they do in their actions. And that's what you're going to go have those conversations about.
Yeah. And I think just to add to that, I think it goes back to our initial discussion of just asking. So that's another thing. Like if you, for me, what works is that if I find somebody who is, who I feel that I will connect with or can benefit from, I try to go and ask that person, like, will you go out for a coffee or will you be okay for a 30-minute chat with me? So I think that asking portion is very important. The other thing to your point, Philip, that we have like social media platforms and whatnot. So the other thing that works is that you can go to like, maybe you don't have access to a large group of people. Maybe you're new to the country. Maybe you are new to the culture. You don't understand where to start. So my advice would be just go to the networking events. There are a lot many that happen. Just find people there. See who you resonate with. Talk to them. LinkedIn is a great source. Like find people who are working in the same domain that you are interested to work in or you need mentorship on. Just don't be afraid to ping them and ask them whether or not you'll be open. And believe me, like it does work that way. Like it at least has worked for me. So I think that's one good way to proceed together.
Yeah, and I think another way is if you don't know where to start, if you network within your peers and try to find someone who already has a mentor and get their advice how they got to that point, or if their mentor can find another mentor for you, that's another way to find.
Yeah, that's a great idea.
And I'm just going to do a selfish plug because Electro-Federation is the Electrical and Automation Industry Association. There's lots of networking. There's lots of committees. There's lots of ways that you can sit beside people that you know normally sit beside and learn from them. I learned so much from the years of volunteer work that I did with EFC before I joined EFC. And it's really important. As a matter of fact, when I interview each board member to ask them why they want to be an EFC board member, their first thing is networking and learning from others. Those are the top two.
You know, that's why I was looking more at the beginning, you and I.
One of the things that I think makes it so hard for women to build a career in electrical industry or other industries that are dominated by men is that sometimes consciously, sometimes subconsciously, men tend to form these so-called boys clubs. And one of them gets promoted, then the other ones gets promoted. And if you're not in it, it sometimes can be as an obstacle. Have you encountered it in your companies? And if so, how did you go around it?
I was like, yes. I don't want to, name, but that was me. I thought my previous firm, you know what, force it, you just have to get up. So that's what I did. So I started, my previous firm was the case. And you know what, for a while I tried hard. I worked like 70, 80 hours a week. I'm like, you know what, I'm doing the same thing everybody else is doing. Why isn't anything happening? So at the end, I kind of made the decision, I'm not gonna be in that company anymore. And then you move to a different one, which has a better culture. And then they kind of give you an environment that you can you can improve and you can be yourself. And so the culture makes a difference. So if you don't try to force it and fight it, if it doesn't happen, just you have to go to a place that it inspires you and allows you to spread your wing and the being. So that was me. So I came to MCW and I love it here, and I'm planning on staying here for a long time. And they gave me the opportunity to just be myself and get better and move up and improve the career wise. So
I can say in my experience, there was a period in time where I felt like I wanted to grow and was looking around for where those growth opportunities, and it was seemed to be on the golf course. And I decided I was going to pick up golf, and I'm absolutely horrible at it. And I just determined that was me trying to fit into their stereotype, and I just needed to be myself. So I learned how to golf. I could do it miserably with friends. I will not do it on a professional level at any sort. And I just needed to find my own way, which was different than on the golf course. So, you know, it's good to want to try new things, but if it doesn't fit, don't make it fit.
Yeah, don't force it.
No.
Any other questions?
I have a question.
First of all, thank you so much. I work with Ontario Clean Water Agency and a young professional still new to Canada. My question is, I'm trying to speak for the young professional, particularly women who are new to the industry. And I want to know from the experts what their take on this is. So the question is, as women, we often hear from our peers, mostly men, you got this easily because you are a woman.
That's true.
Comes a lot, and I have had this question coming to me, not from Canada, but from other part of the world. And then it sort of kills your morale, lowers your spirit, and you're like, why did I even get into engineering? I should have gone for some other kind of trades. And then that is enough. And I've heard from many people that that was one of the main reason why they figured out they should not be there. They need to go out. But going out is like giving up, isn't it? It's not the right thing to do. So I would like to know from the expert what the subtle professional way for the young professionals to deal with these kind of behaviors at workplace would be.
Interesting
question.
I agree with you because I've heard that so many times, and I take that to my advantage, right? I mean, hey, it's a one way of to, you know, I shouldn't say get noticed, but why wouldn't you use that to your advantage if you're the only female? I'm not gonna decide as I go. I just don't let things like that bother you. Whatever makes you, if you're passionate about what you're doing and you love what you're doing, just push through it and use that for your advantage. I mean, that's what I've been doing. So I don't know. I mean, I've been working sort of.
Yeah, that's a hard one because somebody has just insulted you. Mm-hmm. And you want to be equally as insulting back. But it's not going to get you anywhere at the end of the day.
No.
I think what you have to do at that point is take the higher road and don't get that personal satisfaction of just, you know, punching them in the nose, and take the higher road because that'll make you feel better later. And then just don't associate with people like that. You know, there are people like that. And that comes from a place of jealousy. It comes from, just not a nice place. And try to move your circle to others. And if that person happens to be in a power position and you can't get by it, well, we have choices. We don't have to be there. And too bad for them if they're not going to empower you because you're great at what you do. So if you just flip the head a little bit, but don't punch.
Sometimes you.
Just in your head as you're walking away.
Sometimes.
Take up boxing instead, right? But I think those kind of comments, I would say those are noise, and you need to use that to your advantage and use that energy to build your confidence and show and surround yourself with people who empower you and that will help you to get to the next level. So. And that's my advice. I have heard that comment before as well.
Yeah, I think we all have.
We all have.
I think the one thing I would add is the feedback needs to go into the organization and that person needs the feedback. And I think there's a subtlety of this and it's much more complicated than what I'm saying, but wherever possible, if there's an opportunity to share that feedback in a safe way so that progress can be made, I would encourage you to share that feedback. Certainly in a company like ours, there's ways that can be shared without repercussion, but so that the culture can be improved upon. So I would say I 100% agree with what everyone said, but that sort of feedback, it's hidden sometimes. And so I, at least me leading this organization, I would hate if that stuff is happening and I'm not aware and we're not doing something to address it.
You know, Adrian, you're so right, because the response I gave, I would call it a traditional response, is be quiet, you know, and then shift yourself and then do something else. The braver thing would be to do as you're suggesting, but in a safe way, because there really shouldn't be room for that.
But that's the thing again, the onus is on us, where we're used to, because we've been in this industry for so long. I mean, that's all.
Yeah.
But we're used to that kind of ignore things and not let things like that bother us instead of speaking up and trying to fix the issue and the problem versus just ignore it, right?
And hope that you have a leader like Adrian.
Yes. Right?
That will take it seriously and do something about it. But there are more and more leaders like Adrian, and there is a higher consciousness about this now. So there are more opportunities to speak out than there ever has been, right?
Yeah.
And I think to that, you know, one of the things is, again, don't be quiet. Say, why would you say that? What is in your perspective? Because maybe it is coming from a place of just ignorance and they don't understand some of the challenges that we have as women. And so maybe this is an opportunity to educate. I do recognize, though, I think what ends up happening in the real world is it's probably a melding of all of these solutions, because it depends on who that person is to you who just said it. I think it also depends on your personality. Lots of people aren't comfortable with something that has the potential to be confrontational. I am okay with making people uncomfortable generally, so because I want that conversation to happen. But I recognize that's not a solution for everybody. So it is a lot of, you're going to have to kind of feel that out as an individual. But I agree that it is that quietly we're accepting that this happens. We're saying it's not okay, but we're not changing it. And that's where I do think we need to be much more vocal in a safe way to say, no, this is actually not okay. But I do think it's important too to talk to the person who said it, just so that you understand their perspective. That, I mean, sometimes it's blatant. Again, you know that you're not misunderstanding, but it could just be somebody misspoke and you're misunderstanding. You don't want to add your assumptions into what somebody else is saying too, right? So I want to have that conversation with that person and hopefully avoid punching the note. Although sometimes you do.
I think like just taking one more step back as well is important. Like when somebody says something like that to you, it's one thing to ignore it, not think about this in this way that, okay, that doesn't really bother me. But a step back is this, that when somebody says something like this that actually bothers you, you kind of start losing your confidence and you are like, is this the right place for me to be in? So I believe the first step would be just understanding that if somebody is saying something, try to understand where they're coming from, but don't let it bother you and then speak up about it. So that's, that's something that's important as well. So.
Yeah. Any last words? Okay. If not, I would like to thank again to our panelists and Adrian for joining, as well as our audience. And those of you who are joining virtually, it's been a very powerful discussion and we need to continue these type of conversations in the industry. So thank you so much for joining us and I hope you all have a fantastic day.
Thank you.